I'm Steve Cantwell with Green Life Productions. We're here to walk around Liberté Talk Shop.
We're at your facility here in Pahrump, Nevada. And it's amazing. We haven't even really cracked the real secrets or the, yeah. So, well, actually, maybe we have, because we're starting to talk about the compost and what makes the plants grow. So
yeah, so we're about to step into that area. Are you guys good over here? This is the greenhouse project, future greenhouse project, about to start up again.
Well, I can see it because we've been talking, but we're talking next year, 3 years out?
So we've actually been planning this for about 2 years. We really hit it hard early this year, but then the COVID thing hit. So we pumped the brakes. Now that hype is kind of settling down, we're confident to start this project back up again. So we're hoping to start getting things ordered here in the next several weeks.
Hopefully by next year. It looks like you guys already prepared the slab, so it's just pouring steel structure like the rest, so that goes up quick.
It's gonna be relatively quick. I think about 6 month time period from start to finish. So by next summer we should be, if everything goes right, we should be having our first sun grown crop by late next summer.
Perfect timing.
It'd be nice. This, all right, so this is basically, this is the what we're currently operating in. It's about 12,000 square foot indoor space. And then over here to the right, this is just our storage space. This is where we just kind of store all of our amendments. Then I have a little pad over here where we do most of our compost, not most, we do all of our composting.
Is your compost over here? Can we take a look?
I don't have any compost right now because we just got through, I have some indoors, but we're not composting right now because of summertime, the summer heat.
So talk a little bit about your compost, what you were talking about, the timing of it, when you do it, and what your process is.
So over here, it looks like you have some of your feedstock, probably some biochar, some alfalfa, it looks like, some straw.
Yep.
I'm not sure what's in the other.
So that's a couple totes of peat moss left over from when we did that big soil mix. Okay. And then we have a couple totes or a couple soil bags of pumice from that same soil mix. But then you're right, we have both alfalfa and straw. And then, just trying to store various amendments dry. And you're right, biochar is
great,
that black one.
Great space. Like, honestly, you got to have space because when you need it, that's that bulk.
100%. Yeah. Yep. It's a little messy out here right now. I got to clean up
so
a little bit.
So we've got, looks like trim, which is being dried, so you can be added to the compost as well.
So yeah, so this is our official composting area. This is where we store all our dry amendments. So any of our cannabis leaf, stem, we actually get a little bit of manure. We store dry oak for our brown. And then we basically store it all here. And then you see some of our pallets with meshes, some of our compost fences or cages. And then,
it looks like these are movable. You got a forklift. Do you utilize that in the composting process, turning, or is it just in finish?
No, we don't really use a forklift for them, to be honest. We just use that to get them off the ground. So we just build our little pallets. Yeah, for the bottom. Yeah. This is our leaves. So these are the leaves we've been storing and drying all summer. Again, we're about to fire up the composting process. So about to burn through all these. And this is
how much are we looking at? This is the product. I mean, this is not much, is it? Or and what are we looking at?
This is the water leaf. I couldn't tell you. There you go, a little Swarovski pack.
Yeah.
I couldn't tell you, but we had the paperwork that I pointed to, though.
So you have to, are you going to put it in the compost? You don't have to destroy it, right?
So this is just drying out. This is about to get all scooped up and put in a bag like this. Oh, okay. And then if you look at this is... So we store everything dry, just like Elaine teaches in her classes. So
now this is just like the leaves and the fall, right? You collect them, you have them stored dried. They're prepped and waiting to be then utilized in your compost when you're ready to build.
Yep, pretty much. And then here, usually this corner back here would be filled with oak or some type of brown material. Inside those trash bags is just unused cannabis stem. A lot of this stuff gets chopped and dropped on our beds, but our beds can only take so much at once without smothering them. That's why we have to take some of this stuff out here and dry it out here and incorporate it in the composting process. This is probably one of my funner places of the whole facility, especially this time of year when it's starting to cool off. We can actually get going out here with composting. You'll see me out here quite a bit.
So when you are flipping your pillars, is it more of a agro style Or is it more of like, here you go, flop you over?
My first couple of piles, I was more CrossFit in my in my methods. Definitely went a little hardcore. Yeah. Hurt my shoulder at one point.
Yeah, I blew out my freaking rotator cuff. Yeah.
You have your bandages off.
Yeah, and I'm letting it air out today. Yeah, letting it air out. But no, I actually have a style of flipping it now, inside out, top to bottom. Yeah. That really turns it nice. You got to take your time.
It's a flow.
Yeah.
I noticed too that there's a down pressure, like when you're going in, so it doesn't just fall apart.
Yeah.
Like you come in and you push down, okay. Not just lift. Yeah. And so, because you're really just trying to, you're not making a mess, you know? You're literally just creating oxygen and aeration and...
I'm real big on getting that outside in and that inside out, you know? Yeah. So I'm always trying to separate the pile when I reflip it.
But, yeah, smart. You gotta work it all in.
Work it in,
dude,
man.
This looks great and excellent work area. Looks like some river rock, and this is probably for the new beds coming in.
So, this is excess river rock. In all my beds inside, I have... We throw various piles of rock in the corners or in the middle of the beds just to create like a rock mulch environment. The consistency, the moisture consistency under the rock stays the same. Yeah. It doesn't dry out as fast. It doesn't get as wet. So you tend to see more worms and just more biology right under the rocks.
But there are diverse ecosystems within an isolated island.
Mulch, you have their little rock mulch. So yeah, it just gives a different environment for things.
And because it's not organic, it doesn't actually contribute to like pill bugs or, you know, something like that. Yeah. Yeah.
So, which we have, which I love.
I know, aren't they great? They last for years.
It's a love-hate, but I love. They're here.
Well, you just got to feed them enough.
Yeah.
You know, or they'll start eating other things.
Yeah, yeah.
So, excellent, man. Well, thank you so much for sharing outside. Let's go inside.
You got it. So, you guys are going to have to, you guys got your IDs?
Yep. Now we'll figure out the whole process.
Is that one you guys? Yeah.
So what's your process?
You guys are going to put booties on, and then I'm going to go in here and you guys hang out for me, and I'm going to get you guys some scrubs, and we'll get you guys all scrubbed up.
So I can feel the air coming out. This is part of your HVAC, but we were talking about you don't actually use much. Like you're a very efficient system.
You'll see how we use it. This is its own unit in here. Everything has controlled air. No, we don't share air in any of our rooms. So yeah, this is just the office space. So the big thing here is just make sure you have clean filters, obviously high grade filters, and then purification. Yeah. So have to some type of UVC light in your ductwork. Make sure that you're cleaning the air. Yeah. All right, so this is the basically the kind of the beginning of a tour, I guess. This is our open locker room. So we kind of did like an open locker room to try to avoid theft and things like that. So open locker room with clear lockers really makes that kind of hard to.
No pushback by anybody.
No, it was just dressing rooms. So open locker room with private dressing rooms was the idea here. Employee break room down there, some offices for my wife. Nothing too fancy. Then we got our security booth right here. Where he has access.
Food, very nice break room, by the way. And you have pastries there for your Saturday crew, which is like really so nice.
So usually they take care of, someone will bring them in and take care of each other. But then the security booth here, he's all behind ballistic glass, ballistic walls, access to all the cameras.
All state requirements.
He's all legit. Over here is our sally port, where just pretty much just all our materials, nothing really to see there. Kill bug.
I know.
This is our trim room. We'll go to this sink right here and we'll wash up.
Hey, everybody.
What's up, guys?
Hi.
Good morning. We'll just wash up right here.
So talk to you about your trimming. Everything's hand trimmed?
Yep, all hand trimmed. In a nice environmentally controlled room. So we're not deteriorating our product as we're trying to clean it up. So
do you have trim days or are they busy? Is it like every day?
No, we typically run 5 days a week. Then if we're backed up, we have an excess of strain or something like that. We'll offer overtime on the weekends. I think it looks like we had a crew take us up on the offer this weekend, so we got the whole crew showed up, or at least a lot of them.
It sounds like a real quick turnover from your processing. From pulling down the flower to in the jar, not pulling down the flower, but out of cure. Like, how long before it's on the shelf?
Typically for us, I would say roughly 4 weeks, 4 or 5 weeks. So it's a 14-day dry period. Then we trim it up. It takes about a week to trim it up before it gets tested, then a week for testing. So that puts us at about 4 weeks before we can package it, and then on the fifth week it's packaged and sold. And depending on strains, some strains we hold back on. They need more time. Some strains we try to put out in a hurry because we know those terps don't last as long. So fruity stuff goes out first. It's kind of the rule of thumb.
Fruity goes first.
There you go.
Yeah, that sweet tone is lost, and then it gets that tartness, which I kind of like sometimes.
And the spice, they get a little spicy sometimes, too. So one thing we had to recently do is we actually expanded our trim room. Where you see that wall cut out, that was actually a wall at one point. And then we have another 4,000 square foot beyond that wall that we're going to expand into for more dry space with our future greenhouse and our future flower room, indoor flower rooms. But for now, we just do this little pop out. What happened was we changed our lights out, got some new LEDs, some new Phos LEDs, and we had almost a 50 to 100% increase on some strains. So basically we had to build a whole new dry room and a whole more trim space just to be able to handle the extra weight.
Weight in bud set or weight in like biomass growth?
Overall bud set and just overall pre-roll, every part of the plant's volume went up, both our pre-roll material, our jarable material.
Wow, that's
excellent. We had, like I said, a 100% increase on some strains. Minimum 50% increase across the board. But we did that, and we have our little trial half station over there that we're building out right now. Just got all our final little tools in.
Tell us about the next venture you guys are working on.
Yeah, you guys want to go check it out? Can I get by real quick, guys? Hey, Jason, mind if I get by real quick?
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, brother. So this is just a temporary little area. This isn't a hash lab that we're content with.
But you're going to transition, or at least use some of your produce, right? And turn it into hash.
So the idea is right now we don't have a very big volume to work with to launch a hash line. Mm-hmm. But what we're going to use the little bit of volume we do have with is to do the R&D in preparation for our greenhouse project and the rest of our indoor. So when that time does come, now we have some experience. We know how to make it the most efficient, the best hash we can with what we had to work with.
And scale up
from there.
Perfect.
So that's what this is. We went with the brutless hash washing vessels. We got the Sasquatch rosin press with the Harvest Right freeze dryer. So we got all the cool tools, got some big freezers in the Sallyport. So we should be able to make some nice stuff here. Here we got another dry room, check this out.
That looks new.
Yeah, this is none of this has been used yet. This is all just installed.
It's waiting.
Fresh toys, beautiful. Pretty much. You got it.
So do you do your like the pre-rolls in here? Do you have a pre-roll day and then everything that type of stuff is done?
Yeah, right now we just have a handful of people trimming. But usually during the week we have a full staff out here. We have trimmers, pre-rollers, packagers. We'll have 20 plus people in here.
So this is like your production room for that type of
thing? This was just a weekend crew who wanted the overtime kind of thing. Typically there's a lot more people in here though. Usually there's an ass in every seat. This is our new dry room that we just built out. We've yet to use it, but just to give you guys an idea of what we got going on. So completely all control through our aeroponics. We have an intake, our fan's not on there, but we have an intake fan, an exhaust fan through a carbon filter, ozone generator when needed. Carbon filters in here to filter out any contaminants, AC unit, humidifier, dehumidifier, so we can keep all those parameters that we're aiming at.
The green lights in this room.
Green lights help keep down the degradation of the plant, so that way when we put the plant in here, it stays sleeping.
How long have to not degrade,
How long are you drying for?
14 days. That's our desired time.
And this will clear out Is this for each bay? Like a cycle?
So basically, there's two dry rooms per bay. Okay. So I'll fill, this is, each one of these, I have two dry rooms that each represent a week.
Yeah. Nice.
So I fill one week, I fill one the next week, and then on the third week, this one's empty again.
And this room looks like it's super easy to reset or sterilize.
To sterilize and break down is a huge part of the design. The only real issue that we had that I didn't like was where the placement of this fan filter is. But the reason we had to do that, the reason it's upside down like that is because the other side of this wall is an AC unit. So we had to work around it. So that's the only pain in the butt in this room that's gonna be able to clean it or change is that filter up there. But other than that, it's meant to just be able to be sprayed down and washed down easily.
Oh, you got a green. Greens are cool. A green. So does the whole place close down by 5? Is that like
typically we run 5 days a week. We try to run this place like a regular business, give people their lives.
We were talking about the light cycle.
Yeah, what happens? Yeah, because of the light cycle.
Okay.
But that's
just a dry room. So our flowering rooms, we typically our lights are off at 5. That's why you guys are limited yesterday. Actually, one of my rooms is off at 4. It's a little further in the cycle, so we knock another hour off. This is just a light Eagle 20 Avid mix, just to make sure we kill anything that
Excellent.
You guys could
That's
be bringing
really
in.
Important.
Just to be safe, you know, safety first.
Can I taste it first?
It's just a Dr. Bronner's and essential oil from Build a Soil, so it's just pretty much you're gonna smell lemongrass. And I'm mainly spraying
peppermint.
I'm just spraying your legs, just in case you walked in with anything. Cause you guys usually have the same shoes on. Let's just do a quick rinse right here, or we're supposed to wash our hands again, or use the alcohol.
So for your SOPs, it's enter every room, wash your hands.
Usually we'll skip the trim room, so my growers will skip that and just come right to here. But we walk the trim room, so we had to wash there and wash here. So
contamination vector. Yep.
Listen, I really appreciate this.
This is excellent, man. So tell me about the little ones.
Oh yeah, welcome to our bedroom. Yeah. So these are just planted a couple days ago out the clone dome. So they're just kind of working through their stress of getting into their new environment. This is just one round. This is actually in preparation for we have a slightly smaller room out of our three rotation rooms. So this is for one of our smaller rooms.
So let's talk about what's in the pot. These are a transition from clone. Are you? You're not growing out of.
Would you like to?
No.
Okay.
You're not growing out of rock wool, are you?
No. We do unfortunately currently use. That's one of the only limiting factors I have, or not limiting factors, but one of the variables we have is that we're using riot rooter type plugs.
Okay.
We're using it, which is a peat moss base with some type of adhesive. Yeah. So it still breaks down in the system, not very fast, and it's not something
not
I want to use.
It implies a lot quicker.
Yeah.
I actually have some that I'm testing, like literally just put into worm bins where there's so much life, it's crazy, and they're still there.
the best thing I've seen that break them down is the bird's nest mushrooms. So if you ever see bird's nest mushrooms, collect those little seeds and put those in your beds. They love riot rooters, dude.
See how beautiful, thank you. All right, so we have those put into a living soil or a...
So what these are is basically when we plant our beds, the little bit of soil that we take out of our beds to make room for these, we take back and then those go back into the pots. So, and we just rotate our holes every cycle. So we never dig, we never pull the root ball, we dig right next to it.
Yeah.
And then we let the root ball break down, then the next cycle, that's where we take.
That plug then is used to foster the growth and then it allows you that transition back into. Nice.
So this is the same soil that's in our bed. So this is 22nd cycle living soil. This is off the top of the soil. So this is a high concentration of worm castings in this mix here.
Which is nice at this because these are still shock. That helps with the shock stress. Are you seeing the shock stress?
Right. This is about it right now. Again, they're planted 3 days ago.
Yeah.
So we're literally in the heat of the stress right now.
Exactly.
So in about 3 days, they should start coming back to normal and start showing some growth. Right now, they're just adjusting to their new environment. And like you said,
that's totally. I'm talking about when it transitions to the beds.
Oh,
because this ecosystem is so similar to what they're going into because it's just been removed for a short time.
Yeah,
are you seeing the heat, the transition stresses there? You'll always see some because you're cutting off the root hairs.
There's other variables that we've ran across. Like recently, we changed our lights up. So we planted into rooms with that new variable that we had to adjust to, like, oh, too much light, too little light, because it's a whole new system. So we've had to adapt.
You're still in that fine tuning.
But
you really like it, though.
We're re-fine tuning now. After 5+ years, we just changed the biggest input in the whole facility, the lights. So now we had to kind of refigure things out again and kind of re-fine tune. But for the most part, yeah, we're loving every part of it.
And these beds here, from my understanding, this is part of what you're using for your cloning process.
Yes, sir.
All right. So tell us what's happening.
So we try to grow as much of the inputs that we use as possible. So aloe is one of the things that we use the most. As you guys know, it has high in salicylic acid, good saponin. So it's just a good thing to both feed the plant.
Can I get a closer look?
Yeah, you're fine. Yeah. And it's good for foliar feeds, it's good for the cloning process. So it's just a good plant to have around. It's super easy to grow. So
on top of the fact that it's good for the people too.
Yes, it's good. Honestly,
should be in everybody's garden.
If someone with fair skin to get sunburned, I definitely had my fair share of aloe rubbed on me.
So what is happening with these beds? Are plants going in here?
So this is a mother bed that we just cleared out. We're about to plant another cycle of mothers. Basically, this is kind of our worm bin, really. All of our excess organic material that our beds can't take, that we don't feel like taking outside, kind of gets thrown right here and the worms just devour it. So this is kind of our mother bed / worm bin.
It's hard to describe sometimes. And this, because this is an ecosystem. Like, this is a perpetuation of the nourishment that is, like, if you needed something, well, where do you go get it? Right here. Right? And so in my garden, the whole garden ecosystem, like, you literally go into the trail and pull up your material for your potting plant.
Yep.
Right? So, and that's what this allows you to do too.
One thing I've been doing with this mother bed I haven't really talked much about online yet, but I've been seeing really good results with, is when I'm done with a mom, I'm pulling that root and I'm putting it in a tea brew immediately. And I'm getting much shorter brew times because I'm working with active microbes now.
Yeah, it's an extraction.
They're not dormant. So
The whole rhizosphere, boom.
So boom, right there. So I'm not wasting these moms at all now.
Nope.
So I've been doing that for the last, I would say, almost this last year, really. And I've been really enjoying that because I'm getting something out of this bed now as well.
It also allows you to really, I do that as well. And that allows me to see the root growth. Like, especially in a no-till situation, I never dig up the whole root system to see what it looks like. But if I can shift that out and go, this is what I'm really working with underground, it's really kind of a cool perspective.
Yeah, it can open your eyes too, to some of the problems.
Problems or successes,
yeah,
good point. Like, where's your root depth going and how,
This is something cool I saw him look at. This is something,
beautiful.
This is from home. This is it's an African baobab tree. This is the Madagascar trees.
It's the
tree of life, some of the oldest trees on the planet. I had one, but it's a tropical tree and it gets cold out here, so I didn't want to plant it outside. So I bonsaied it several months ago and brought it to GLP, and it is blowing up. It grows like a half an inch a day. I actually broke a branch off at one time and had to nurture it back. I wrapped it up with some aloe, rehealed it.
So what does it mean when you bonsai it?
Basically, you cut the roots and you stunt its growth. You stifle its growth.
So why is it still growing?
Because you didn't kill it.
Because I didn't kill it. And it's at GOP and it's getting the best compost teas and the best extracts that you
can imagine.
Because
it's grown with this life, buddy.
So does that mean it just doesn't get as big as it would?
Yeah, you're holding it back. Once a year, what I'll end up doing is there's wires that are actually holding it down to that pot. Once a year, I'll cut those wires. I'm going to up pot it, cut the roots, and then repot it in the same pot.
Is that how they get the bonsais to bend with those wires?
That's just manipulation over time. The real bonsaiing is how you deal with the roots. Most people only think of how the little tree is shaped. But the real shaping goes below
as above is below. So you got up prune that below, just like you would the top. And the bonsai is actually more important is the root zone. So anyway, so this is our mom bed. It's about to get freshly planted again with the new run of moms.
So let's talk about what we're seeing, a different kind of aloe, smaller, but what else is happening life-wise in the bed? And by life-wise, we'll talk about the microbes and the worms and stuff, but also the green, you know, the other than cannabis life.
So we use various companion plants. They're breaking it down. But for the most part, the most two that we use them for ground cover purposes, is just dichondra and then chickweed. I'm a personal fan of chickweed. It actually helps with the peel bugs. I feel like our beds that have high concentration of chickweed have the lowest population of peel bugs. So this right here is a dichondra. It's just it serves a really good ground cover. We don't have to reseed it. It grows back all on its own. I've never seen it go to flower, unfortunately, but it's a super low maintenance. All you gotta do in the beds, if it gets out of hand, is just gotta chop and drop it before it gets too bad. The peel bugs.
And it doesn't have such an aggressive root like a mint. Like that, you know, that penetrates and spreads. How's the root system on this?
If you overseed it, it's a nightmare.
Okay.
And that's a big thing people have problem with dichondra, is they'll either overseed it or undermanage it, or both. They'll overseed it and undermanage it, and then they'll just have this jungle mess of a cover companion plant growing. But so if you don't overseed it and you maintain it and you keep it down, it's fine. It's 100% manageable. You don't have to waste energy and time reseeding it. It's just gonna pop back up on its own. I like this over clover. We started the facility off with clover. Clover has its place in some places.
Like subalpine or not white Dutch or?
More crimson clover than anything. And then it was a mix of some other things, red clover, crimson clover.
Those get large.
Yeah, they you gotta maintain them. But the problem with the clover is those high-end plants, those legumes, is that they attract a lot of pests. Yeah. So a lot of thrips, aphids, anything you can imagine that liked high-end, they're just a breeding ground for them. So it kind of became a problem after the years of just kind of having to redeal with that. There's also a plus side. Certain things like the clover more than the cannabis. So having the clover would keep things off your cannabis as well. So, there's really some pros and cons and ways to look at it. We got rid of the clover.
Your variables is where you go, this one works for us, super low maintenance, it does its purpose, adding exudation to the soil structure.
I don't need, nitrogen is an easy building block to replace. I can always top dress with some alfalfa. So it's not something I need to grow in the beds if it's causing that much of a problem, clover does. What's that?
How old is it?
This bed, we didn't start with this bed, so this bed's a little newer, but it's old potting soil dumped in. I want to say this one's 2 or 3 years old, I would say, so chickweed and dichondra are our most popular ones that we use, but we have other companion plants we use for different reasons. I use a lot of trap planting, so I'll plant specific plants just to attract the pests. I use clover for a trap plant, actually.
Yeah.
And then another thing I do is we plant a lot of banker plants, like pepper plants. Purple flash peppers, things like that. You'll see in various throughout the rooms.
So what about your choice of container? Is this the Grassroots?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I love the guys over at Grassroots. We started off before I think they were actually open, though. So in my rooms, we actually have old geo planters, the older style fabric beds.
But what do you like about the fabric?
They're just more breathable. They're really good, easy, affordable setup. Nowadays, they make the no-till one, which I kind of help inspire with the less penetratable sides, so you can actually sink the water. I played a really big role in the development of that. So even though you don't see it here, what you're going to see here is old beds wrapped with saran wrap that basically ushered
inspired
that in.
The next next generation.
But what I like about Grassroots is they're an awesome team. Their product speaks for itself. They beefed up their piping, so you don't have this flimsy, weak piping and fittings that are breaking. They went with the tan, so it's not attracting heat, especially when you're in the outdoor environment.
And you'll be able to maintain this environment in this bed for as long as you want?
We're testing that theory out right now, seeing how far we can push it. Right, 22 cycles deep and going strong. 22.
So we were thinking about that. We thought that would be like 4 years or something, but it's Yeah.
Five and some change. So I basically get four and some change, four and a third cycles a year out of each room. I have three rooms, so I get roughly 13 harvests a year.
When some people hear that, they say, oh, he's almost burned out of his newts. He's going to have to flip, you know, it's a five-year cycle or soil. You're saying this is how far we've run, but we're continuing to run. We're going for...
My newts, and it's quite the opposite, man. Honestly, the only problem I have right now with my soil is that it's too rich. So now I can't top dress anything, just maybe a little bit of alfalfa to make up for the nitrogen.
No, I'm finding it too. There's a weird balance where the beautiful worm activity in nature, that would be separated and moved around, and you know, but in a bed it gets really concentrated, super rich, and it's hard to like bump the carbon up without it being a sink at that point. Yeah, it's tough, it's tricky,
right? But anyways, so yeah, this is veg. This is kind of where we get everything big before loading into the rooms. You see some of our extra clones that we didn't plant yet, just backups. That's our other little cloning area right here. They're getting burped out right now.
Let's go and check out your tea brewer. And this looks like how you move it around and then disperse.
This is kind of a mess right now.
We don't have to see it.
Let me settle this out a little bit.
See, because liquid is the difficult thing to move. And so have an efficient, and yet still not killing the organisms, because the liquid is really the transport medium, right?
Yeah.
And so, well, then you use a pump that kills everything. What the heck have you been doing? You know, it makes no sense.
We have diaphragm pumps, so it's...
Exactly, perfect.
It's kills less. We test the tea both in the brew and out of the hose to see the difference. You see a little bit difference. You might not see as big as strands of fungi, but they're still there. They might get beat up a little bit, but they're still there.
What are you looking at?
This is just two little tea brewers.
It's your compost tea brewer.
Yeah.
That's why I turned it to you. But the important part that he shared was actually the diaphragm pump. Instead of it being a impeller that's spinning and chopping and forcing, it's just doing this motion.
So you're
not shredding the life that you just grew.
You're not blending it. You're not putting it through a blender, basically. But these are some of our... So one cool thing is that when we designed this facility, I was real big into permaculture and capturing and storing energy and whatnot. So we actually designed every single room, this pipe right here, that recycle water, that's the feed line off of all of our dehumidifiers from each room. And it goes into a catch tank. And then from that catch tank, we put it through a UV light and through heavy sediment filtration. No RO, we're not wasting.
Hold on. So it goes into the tank, and in the process, it gets ultraviolet.
Then from that tank, it gets pumped out of that tank through an ultraviolet and heavy sediment filters, carbon filtration, and then it gets put into our storage tanks that feeds the rooms. So we're basically catching, at this point, I would say up to like 60-70% of our water. The only water that we're losing is through our AC units. Which we're then eventually catch as well.
Yeah.
And do the same thing.
Have you ever tested before you ultraviolet it?
No, never have. It'd be fun to look at though.
Because you're actually pulling, right? The moisture, the micro, the stuff in the air. I'd be curious to see what
it's
it looks
more,
like.
It's not so much off
the machine?
It's not so much the air chemicals or the air pollutants that we're worried about in the water, which we are, but also the shit that's in the pipes, algae and all that stuff growing in the pipes. That you also want to kill.
I'm curious to see what that looks like too, because that's where a lot of people end up with a cesarean issue.
So this, these are light controllers, pretty sweet, folks. This room was just planted, so plants are a little small, a little stressed out. Don't freak out.
It's crazy to be going into an LED room and not have it be purple.
Have the what?
Not be purple.
Oh, yeah. This place was purple for a long time.
Like, for reals, like, I...
So this, it was just right planted...
So I can make them look green, but they already look green.
It was planted last week, so we're about 8 days into planting in this room. So they just got through their stress. They're actually just starting to grow. Yeah, you go in. We're still cleaning this room, still breaking it down, still prepping
I just want to look out, because we're talking about where the rock placements and how these ecosystems are set up. Or if we can do that in another room, that's fine too.
We can do it in this room, fine. I mean, we can do it in that room
more
too.
More mature.
Yes, go in another room. But this room was just planted. This is a 20-second cycle.
How many plants in there?
It depends on strain.
So light barrier on the exterior of the door.
Yeah, we still seal them, yeah. But this is just foolproof. That way, if one of these pops off or something happens, we don't see the whole fucking room. All right, guys. Welcome to our 22nd cycle. Sorry.
So this is a part of your 22nd cycle.
Yep. This is our first room in our 22nd cycle.
They're looking great, man.
This whole row right here is all black triangle. In the middle, there's some potted plants and some Thailand. To our right, we have some great pie number 5. This isn't the winning phenotype. This is actually the pheno that I breed with. It's super grapey, so I use it because it's the grape that I want in the breeding project. The other pheno we have is higher testing. Still grapey, not nearly as grapey as this.
Now, when you're talking grapey, are we talking like grape bubblegum grapey, or are we talking
grape
like
candy? Grape candy. Like a straight up grape candy. Delicious, absolutely. The smell and the flavor it translates very well. Overall, though, this one is my favorite pheno to smoke, just for flavor. That's why I'm using it in the breeding. But the other one is gonna sell better because it has a higher testing in this market.
Tell them how better this one is. This is part of shifting that conversation, because we smoked some great flower last night, but it's about what you're growing, you know. And when you say this one holds a note that it cuts through, that has value.
Well, the thing is too, though, is that people don't value terpenes as much as cannabinoids yet, even though this one has a higher terpene profile.
The customer on paper.
Yes.
Okay.
And they don't test for flavonoids yet, so like this might have that. Like, I don't see the grape in the terpene profile. The grape must be a flavonoid, in my opinion, because this terpene profile doesn't differentiate between other terpene profiles that don't have grape.
And then it's all word of mouth at that point, and. So if you can't smell the product, you can't touch the product, you can't, you know, anything the product before you pay for it, you have to see it on a piece of paper. Or beautiful labeling or jars or, yeah.
That helps. Yeah. It's attractive. Pretty flowers.
That's right.
This is Fire Angel. This is a CBD strain right here. 2-1. These are my sativas. They're blowing up. A little yellow leaves on the bottom. Nothing too bad. Yellow.
So this is actually one of the great things of the living soil bed, is that process makes sense. If you don't have the roly-polies and the pill bugs to eat that, it makes no sense, because that's now a vector for bacteria and fungi and other things to break it down.
Yep.
You gotta have the breakdown process or it's a problem.
And that's why the relationship with mealybugs is, it's a love-hate, yep. Man. I love them.
Gotta feed them.
But you just gotta feed them, man.
And Tom, if it's okay, I don't know how you mess with your beds. Like, I usually am just hands in and looking. But I'd like to roll the stone over just to see, and you can take a video.
Yeah, let's grab a bigger one, though.
Find one that usually is active. We don't have to
this
use...
This is a small base one, so yeah, it's not too much underneath it. We'll find a big flat one.
But this is that importance of showing that life, too.
Steve, how do you water in here? Where's your watering system?
What's
your water? Your watering.
A hand water.
You hand water?
Hand water. Yeah. I have 3 rooms like this. They're all hand watered, and I have two growers.
Is it
that
on
run
schedule?
Them.
On schedule?
Yeah, the schedule changes throughout each one's cycle, but yeah, we have a very, very strict watering schedule that we follow. Obviously, depending on what the plants are telling us, the soil is telling us, but. Hey, you see this?
Yeah, they eat that better than this.
No, that's a chipmunk. We have a chipmunk or a rat that got in. We've been hunting him for 6 months.
I'll get him for you.
He loves our predator packs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are these?
They're predator packs. They're Swarovski mites. Okay. So it's a beneficial insect.
Yeah, there he is.
Little packs. That's what. Yeah.
Yep. We've been hunting them for a minute. Let's go to the other side.
Hey, you know what Elaine would say? Throw a bird in here and you have the complete soil food web.
He actually eats the cover crop. We'll come in here and see how the it's on the sides. He mows it down. Like, we've actually done less cover crop management since it's been in here though.
In the weirdest of ways, I kind of want to eventually get to the fact that you bring your rabbit to work with you and then you put him in the bed. He mows, he poops, because it's cold compost. It's not even hot.
Yeah, that would be right? Cool. That would be cool.
You take your little support animal home.
So that's just another row. Yeah, basically just, this is all happy praying plants. This is our Miss X right here. This Miss X right here is one of our highest testing, highest yielding strains. She's won all the awards for best sativa in the state. She's a...
Even though she's expressing more of a indica phenol?
She's a... half of her is ACDC, CBD, and doesn't even show up. So she's a weird one, man. It's when we say sativa, yeah, we're more associating... We're not... And that's the thing about the old style. So back in the day, if you said indica sativa, and you, it depends who you asked. If you asked a grower, they're going to talk about how tall or short or stout or how quick it finished or how long it right. finished. But nowadays, if you ask somebody indica sativa, they're strictly asking you about the effects. Is it going to make me sleep or is it going to make me up or down? So that, when I said sativa, I was more or less referring to the effect.
This is why there's so much confusion on the customer base, because, well, what are you talking about? And there's no time to explain.
Yeah.
But the effect is often confused by other, like, flavor profiles and what are you looking at?
It's a lacewing larva.
Just needing some love. Look at that. There he goes.
Little predator. Anyway, I mean, that's pretty much... Oh, this is the other grape pie phenol right here.
So have you had your time here?
This is the winter grape pie phenol, technically. This is a mid-30s total cannabinoid. It does have the grape profile. The grape just isn't as loud as the other one, the number 5. This was the number... I can't remember what number this one was. I think it was number 9. I think it was number 9. No, number 12. This is number 12. The other one's number 5. The number 12 is a mid-30 percenter. The number 5 is a 20 percenter.
But holds the stronger note.
Holds a stronger note.
Yeah.
Yep, this is pretty much our rooms, man. This is a 22nd cycle, 3 rooms. So we've done this, at this point, 65 times now.
I'm so impressed with how you keep the consistency of your plants. I don't know how you do it.
This is a...
And multiple strains.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, no, multiple strains. I mean, within
so this is a good example of where... This was last cycle?
Yes.
Which was left in place, just harvested. The next to it in the void, that's where the new plant goes.
And you'll see it in every single one here. This one's already been broken down.
You see how it's broken down? So this is the natural progression.
You can find it right here. It's already broken down and falling apart. But if you look, they're in every single bed right there.
Yeah, exactly.
Right there.
And so this is how you can still maintain the system while using pots to transfer in, because you're only disturbing it as little as possible.
Oh, so these are in pots that you transplanted?
No, this was where our last plant was last cycle.
Right.
Was planted right here. Yeah. Then the plant got cut down, harvested, and then when it was time to replant, we went right next to it. Because what we didn't want to do is that's where all the active biology was last cycle. It was right there in their rhizosphere, right there in their root zone. And if we harvest that, what we end up doing is harvesting 90% of our worms and all the biology out of the bed. So leave that in place. Let that start the next cycle off. Move over.
You're right next to it. You get the benefit of all that biology anyway, yeah. Don't you?
Yeah. Now we're tapping into it the other way. So basically, we just shift grid every single cycle.
So, but I mean, they're planted in, you transplanted. They're not like you didn't. Yeah, okay.
We were in the room with the small.
Now, let me ask you one question. Were all of these in this room transplanted over at the same time, or were different strains brought over at different times?
This room gets cut, they get harvested at different times, but they all get planted the same day.
So they're all at the same stage in their development, yep. But just Timeless. Expressing it differently. It's so fascinating. Yep. I love it. Great. And then you design everything specifically to them.
Yeah, these are the ones. These are the sativas that I'm rotating from room to room. So we're gonna try to get 20 weeks out of these.
Remember last night? These are the plants that take longer, but his rooms are on a 10-week cycle, so he's got to move these plants.
These are the Thailand.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a close look at these beauties. What can you tell us? These are the Thai. This is an authentic, original Thai seed out of Thai seed, right?
Yep. A land race seed brought indoors.
This looks like some marigolds or here.
Yes, I love marigolds and intrepid, and they actually, we did a study on root feeding nematodes, and the marigolds create a biotoxin that appears to deter or kill the root feeding nematode. We did different control methods in several different pots, and we studied it over several cycles.
Excellent.
And at the end of it, the marigolds had the best results after three cycles.
There are multiple species.
This is French, yep.
Okay.
Yeah, but those Thailands, I do believe they are a wild variety. I don't think it was bred. I do think it was whatever is floating around out there.
Still, they're exotic.
Yeah. I don't think there was a selection, though, is what I'm getting at. Those are...
peppers.
No, I think they're purple flash, or those might be the spicy Joes. Oh no, those are the New Mexico's Joe Parker. Yeah.
Okay, can we talk about this environment? Is it the same? What is the plans for? So,
what's the question?
lifespan. Like, what can you like?
No, it's a creature that, as long as he feeds it and loves it, could grow forever.
And that's what we're trying to prove.
Yeah.
Is that, hey, done correctly, we're gonna hit 100 cycles plus out of this, and I really want to show that works. Has it been done yet? No.
This is 20 cycles. We'll say 20 seconds, is 5 years. 20 is 5.
Yep.
And so 100 cycles is longer than most businesses, right? With the same consistency and maturity.
Is the expectation as a grower that the cannabis you grow in the 100 cycle environment will be the same as that was grown in the 22nd? How will that have changed?
Technically, it's supposed to get better with each cycle. As that soil matures, as that soil gets broken down and worked, and
the fungi ratio changes. Some of these fungi take years to literally just be like, okay, they're
set consistent. Their environment. Yeah.
Well, remember, everything in this ecosystem is all about, it has to be conducive for growth. But and the bacteria grow fastest, boom. It can take years for a fungal spore to be like, okay, this environment is healthy long enough that I feel safe enough, comfortable enough to now do my job. Because it's part of that relationship with whoever's on this above and below part. So 15, 20 years from now, you know, what a crazy thought.
I don't know anybody who's gone this far with a living soil indoors, but we definitely want to push the envelope, see how far we can take it. It's already paid for itself 10 times over, there's no reason.
Let's talk about that, because most people, it's always the price tag, which is why they don't want to do new things. But there is an initial price tag, but it's actually not that much. Mostly in the fact that you've got to do more than just fill a bed with bulk peat filler, right? That costs more. But after that, it's not the same nutrition cycle, because the life is actually utilizing what's in that pot.
Yeah.
Right?
A lot. It's similar to the LEDs. It's a more upfront purchase when you're getting into a soil system. It can be, but that's it. It's a one-time purchase. You're not
as well as the hands-on requirement. you know, you're out there making compost. You got to commit to making a compost pillar.
Yeah, it can be. There are some aspects of it that require work, no doubt. Obviously, it's more farming than playing video games. But it's definitely, it's not as labor intensive as people think. Once you really streamline it, make it an efficient process. Like, again, I have three rooms like this. I run with two growers, three of these rooms. So every plant
three
you see.
At this scale,
with two people, and a harvester. So I guess three people.
But that's a different part of the cycle,
yeah,
right?
Only two weeks out of the month I have a harvester come in and harvest. But for the most part, two people grow,
and
plant,
these,
clone.
I didn't see
all
blue
these.
Maps. I didn't see irrigation run everywhere.
All hand watered.
Which for most people is like, oh, you never get the consistency. So how do you train your staff to not just stand there and gossip and flood your bed?
No, they're water ninjas, man. They know what to do.
While we're here, are these your new lights?
Yes, these are my opinion, and I'll fight anybody who says otherwise. These are definitely the best lights on the market, I feel. They're the FOS A3i. It's their flagship light. It's the most overbuilt, awesome piece of grow equipment on the market. It's super solid. They're 1500 watt LED. They're spectrum controllable. They have a program where you can do a sunrise, sunset. They're just the trickiest lights on the market. They did a really good job engineering them and then thinking this light through. Example, if I get a diode out or a bar out, I don't got to change the whole fixture. They come in, they swap a bar out. Just little things like that are just super efficient for me as a cultivator.
The other thing I'm noticing is, like, unlike some other brands where they're kind of, you really have to have a place them really specifically. You have to have a bridge to place your lights. These are pretty, it's like pretty straightforward.
So with
they
these,
can direct the angles too.
Yeah, they have, so you, the, yeah. You can direct the angle, but what's really important is the beam angle that they went with. Some people go too wide, like a lot of the newer LED lights, like the I'm not throwing any brands under the bus, but a lot of the newer leading LED companies, they use a really wide beam angle, which forces you to throw the plants or the lights six inches to a foot above your plants, which doesn't leave space for air to move, which creates, in my opinion, less consistency. And with these lights, they have the power and the beam angle to where you can set them and forget them, which is great for commercial application.
I mean, there's so much space between the light
yeah.
and the plant. There's easily 10 feet.
But it's really good for commercial application because I don't have to chase the stretch now. With the beam angle, I'm not throwing light on that wall over there unless I want to.
That's what I was wondering, because people would say the side of the plant's not getting light, so that's why they're reflecting.
So what I did with these lights is, if you look, I put the outside bar on the row across from it. I forced it out, so I'm getting that to penetrate and slice underneath the leaves. So we're getting tons of penetration with these lights.
Well, yeah, and you can see that in your other plant growth too. Like, you wouldn't have the cover crop or understory, you know, penetrating as well. It's very well done. Your soil is going to outlive your
beds.
Smart.
Yeah, it is 100%. We have to figure that out. It's something that we're.
Yeah, because that's the reality of going, no, if you really do this, that's temporary.
You understand, so far, and that's going to be a testament ultimately, is that so far our soil's outrun our lights, all our first original fans.
Okay, now, Tom, did you hear that? Because when we talk about return and investment, we talk about costs and expenses, most people see it as, when do I have to replace, right? And what he's just said is that what is actually growing his plant has been consistent longer than the lights, because you've changed those out, even the type,
yep.
Right? Staff, right? Like the consistency,
you know,
of the soil.
Is the most important point here. This may look like, you know, any grow room you've seen. This
it doesn't.
Is a living
this
soil
looks way better.
Grow room. This is unlike almost any other grow room that you will find, and that is really unique. That's so true.
At this scale,
so over
this
time,
is the only
then,
one you'll find
you
like
continue
this.
To, in your mind, you kind of continue to reap like financial benefits from working with this type of environment.
Yeah, that's how you become a successful farmer.
Yeah, no, I mean, we're a highly successful businessman. We really want to be able to take our success and share it with good product to the customers, with good jobs for our employees, with a good business for the community. We really want to fire on all cylinders.
That's all great. You have a great product. So thank God you have a great product, you know, out there. But I mean, when you go up, like, you're like, wait a second, man, I'm not going to have to invest as much in it because I'm working with this, you know.
So, and that's the big thing is people look at how much can they get per pound. The question I ask myself a lot is how much am I putting in per pound?
Yeah.
And that's what a lot of people, that's the question they don't ask themselves. One of the things that keeps us so competitive is how little money we spend turning these rooms over. So when I come in, I clean this room, I replant, I probably spend $50 in materials to restart this room, $100 in materials to restart this room.
Yep.
I mean, if you include compost, if I hit a heavy compost, yeah, that might compost, but I make it in-house, so technically it's free, but it would cost about $500 a yard.
And even then you're looking at hours versus days or weeks of labor also requirements to turn.
So, I mean, it cost me $1,000 to flip this room per cycle, not including the power bill, but yeah. So, I mean, that's a huge cost savings that keeps us competitive that we couldn't do without the living soil system.
And that competitive is not just on the market with other products, it's also with the customer base you're trying to actually interact with. If you're just having to cover your costs and you've out-costed most of the people who would really appreciate your product, just because you're being inefficient, right? We're penalizing the people who are so grateful to
us. It's like a park down here. You want to have a picnic down here. It's just beautiful.
That's where the fairies have the picnic.
So yeah, I mean, the idea is to drive the cost down, how much we put into the plant, to drive the quality up, and to drive the yields up. And so, like, so far we've done it. Our quality is has always been top shelf. We've actually just this last year broke into those dream number yields that we've been striving for the last 5 years.
So what's the downside, man? There's got to be something.
No, I mean we're in a regulated market, so I mean we could fail at any minute for anything. We could AC could go down. There's always a risk. There's always rainy days. You know what I'm saying? We still have our issues. It's not it's not all smiles.
Are you able to tap into the local power grid, or you have generator backup?
We have a generator backup right now that handles our security system, but not that wouldn't run our lights. But we are currently looking at a generator that will run our HVAC and lights if needed.
Well, that's a great question because there have been rolling blackouts.
But luckily, our placement, we're in between two power grids. So usually when one shuts down, they transfer power from the other. So we're in actually one of the best locations to have a grow. I don't think we had one for, I think, less than an hour blackout.
How much do you pay for it?
Yeah, I don't know that quite the answer off the top of my head. That is
hey, be respectful, Tom.
It shouldn't be an embarrassing question, but it's a really important one.
Well, when we have costs, you think of the costs differently because it's part of what keeps it everything fed. Right?
Exactly.
When you go at that point, you're like, actually, it's not a cost. I just have to take care of my people. Right?
I went to a massive grow in Eastern Washington State where the energy is like 2 cents a kilowatt. I mean, they pay nothing because that's where they produce like all the energy for the country. And so they're so lucky, but they're, you know, so.
Yeah, but that often breeds inefficiency because it's so cheap. They're like, oh, don't worry about it. It's just $20. But the reality is the
one thing that we have good here going for us, though, is that we don't pay. I just torched that the other day. I brought it in here.
No, I'm looking at the worms already coming up to say hi.
Is that we don't have peak hours. So we have a private power company, and they don't do peak hours. So during the day, like in Vegas, during the day, midday, you're paying more for power. But we don't do that out here, so that's nice. That forces people in Vegas to make their crews work at night and all these ridiculous things to try to save pennies. So it's kind of funny.
Yeah, the road crews are out at 1 o'clock in the morning there's weird little things because the infrastructure doesn't support what everybody has to do to get done. Let's pull that pot. I'll just lift the pot over. And so these have just, don't do it yet. So Tom, why don't you get the camera just close enough? And all we want to do is just a reality that the soil in here is actually already so close to what's in here that the life just transfers between them. Right, and you can see worms literally hanging out the bottom
You see different various mites. You see some springtails. You see some snails.
So that's the only pot flipping you do.
You guys want to talk? I think we should probably have a little bit of conversation outside the rooms too, just in case the fans become a problem.
That's beautiful. And it's exciting.
Oh, real quick, check this out though. Check these lights out.
Yeah.
So, just to give you guys an example, spring, look at this little row right here. Wow. It's all blue now. There you go. Summer. Bring it back to the spectrum of the rest of the room. Boom. And if I wanted to, I can go autumn and really hit the heart, the heavy red. So that's pretty cool light, man.
Very cool.
And then they have this feature here where you can do a scheduling sunrise, sunset. So basically the lights, they don't start off at 100%. They'll start off at the minimum. And they'll let the plant wake up before they hit him with that PPFD.
On the tail end, you know, resting. Yeah.
You start to think you're God or something.
But they're really nice system, man. I highly recommend FOS. If you guys know anybody who's interested in lights, have them hit me up. I'll hook them up with the 18 from FOS and get them dialed in.
Great. Awesome.
Beautiful.
And I like that you're a combination of technology and old school. Yeah, it's good.
Definitely.
Can't go wrong with
them. This is one of our original things I was trying to accomplish. Kind of says it all we're going for, old growth for us. Anyways,
that's a different perspective, right, of what a cannabis grow is. That's what I'm going for too.
That's our mission, you know, 100 cycles. Any other questions before we take off? You gotta have more, no?
Well, I was just saying we get out of the fan.
No, I don't have any questions. My basic feeling is, first of all, it's clean. It's organized so nicely, and I can see how you have complete control over everything, and it's like humming along. And I just asked myself, it's like you were saying, it's like you can't be everywhere at once, and because you do want to get bigger. So it's like, it's so nice at this size, and it's so nice, you know.
I know when we do expand, I'm gonna miss it. I know that. Yeah.
Your expansion is a different type of growth with the greenhouse part. So there's that, but are you gonna put more bays like this as well?
Yeah, so the 35,000 square foot building in front of the Goodwill that you guys saw, right, that will all be built out for more indoor. So we'll have six more rooms.
The Green Life Goodwill.
And I do want to talk about this. Maybe we can talk about it in the other room. But we were talking about, do relatively smaller businesses right now in cannabis have an advantage because they're not over leveraged, yes, they don't have too many things. And so, you know, it's sort of like, what's wrong with running a small business in the scheme of things? Why does everyone have to get huge? So maybe we can talk about that a little bit.
I got caught up in the rat race at first. I thought I wanted a 100,000 square foot.
We get through the science. Most people, that's intimidating, right? We've talked about finances. Most people, that's too intimidating. We talked about, dude, I'm not a farmer. I just grow plant, you know. That's intimidating. How do you deal with going, but I'm still gonna try something that no one else is doing when you're really just trying to meet the medical needs of a community too? You know what I mean? There's a different agenda where the quality is the focus and guess how much our yield is versus, No, we don't care. We just got to push to get this number.
I was kind of blessed with a fearless nature. To me, it was challenge accepted, you know, a kind of state of mind. But for the most part, when you know what you're doing is so right, it's hard for anybody to tell you you're wrong. And that's just something that you just got to
believe in. And the confirmations are literally the plants,
the pill bug, the worm, the
finance book, the satisfaction of your employees, yes, the efficiency of the flow. Like when you go to work, people like to go to work versus a drudgery because of all the managed problems they have to deal with.
100%. This is a living system that we just walked in. I'm not sure if you guys felt it, but there's energy in these rooms. There's a living energy. And when you walk into them, the air is fresh. It's not stale. It doesn't smell like water. It smells like air. Like supposed to smell. So it's just a good, clean, energetic environment. Like when I come here, I drink coffee in the morning, don't get me wrong, But just walking through those door, that door right there, wakes me up, gives me energy, makes me feel alive. So I'm thankful for that.
And that right there should give the person who feels like crap some courage, right? To try something a little different that actually helps lift you up, like the plant reaching out to lift you up, because it's a nurturing environment.
You know, you can talk about this a little bit more when it's quieter. There are so many arguments to transform over to a living soil. And if you can say to someone, and you should really, really nail this one down with people, you would have to replace your system every year. It's like, I don't understand why that really would not resonate with someone. I really don't understand.
What I've heard, and I think this is what we should talk about the house, is actually what I've heard. So I agree. Yeah. There are actual reasons why.
If you want to get to what, like someone's starting a business, they're doing this, the thing that should matter to them, it's costs. Yeah.
No matter what you think.
Dude, I think we'll make it epic, dude. Come on.
Yeah, it'll be epic.
Well, it'll get there. Once I get those hand-caught sharks in it.
You gotta make the grotto, see? Yeah, so you're gonna, that's how you'll end up changing. You'll be like, no, here's some.
Yeah.
We'll get some jade from the California coast and we'll put it in there too. Some abalone shells, mother of pearl.
You see that? I had a piece
shark.
Of shark.
Freaking vicious. I am so grateful to be here. Who are you?
Steve Cantwell with Green Life Productions.
Steve Cantwell. I've heard that name in a lot of different places, but guess what? I'm really happy to hear it right now, because today we went to his facility, which, total grow footage?
What's that?
What's the facility's total grow space currently? Because I know you're expanding, but
currently we're operating about 12,000 square foot.
Okay.
With the potential to grow out to about another 40,000 plus greenhouse, 20,000 foot greenhouse.
The next phases of construction.
Next phase of greenhouse, yeah.
Excellent. It is, it's really great to have been to a facility that sees how the life translates through its process. And this is what I want to talk about. It's not only part of the bed. It's part of the cloning process. It's part of the up-potting process. It's part of the composting post-growth process. It's part of your R&D process. I'm not talking about structure facility, which, by the way, the efficiency is amazing, and the lighting. I'm specifically talking about soil. That life process is a complete cycle. And because of that, there's no misuse of the resource in nurturing your plants.
Yeah.
Which is loss either found in the plant growth, yield, the accountant, right? Your wallet. Like that's where that cycle of waste or misuse starts kicking out, and you're like, oh, I feel it in this area. Time. You know, because I got all these messes to clean up. I didn't see one mess in the entire place.
Keep a clean shop.
Okay. Good. It wasn't, yeah. It's a clean shop, but you didn't say, it wasn't, it's not an unmessy shop, right? Mess is the projects that are half finished, that you step over, that ruin the flow, right?
True.
It's a shit you gotta clean up.
Yep.
And there was no messes, and even the messy room was really because you had to move the thing. Like, hold on one second, it's so messy in here. Like 3 feet of adjustment on something on wheels is not a mess, right?
True.
Okay. So most places, there's a mess somewhere. And that's what is taking all the energy.
And yeah, we definitely run a tight ship. Early on, one of the things that we didn't really have a lot of experience in was a cultivation facility. There was no other cultivation facilities. So what we tried to model after was either a restaurant and or a hospital. Try to keep it clean, try to keep it sterile, because that's who was inspecting our facility was restaurant people.
Yep. So their rule set. Understand.
So we had to keep in mind that people who were coming in that were going to write us a ticket.
What's their pattern?
What was their pass? They were coming from restaurant, the majority of them. So that's why we were so uptight with our
clean walls, clean floors.
Every day we clean our floors. every cycle, we break our rooms down and clean our rooms from top to bottom. Our trim room gets broken down once a month. Our dry rooms get broken down every cycle or every harvest. So, I mean, the whole place is just, we're really, at the end of the day, every single position is a glorified janitor. Yeah. But, you know, it's what we got to do.
What do you mean by janitor? Because I know you're not just meaning toilet cleaner.
No, I just mean we clean up messes, you know, and we don't step over them. Our job is to clean them up and to make sure the place is looking sharp, and that at any one point in time, someone, a state official can walk through it, a patient can walk through it and feel comfortable, a state official can walk through it and not be writing up tickets.
This wasn't a surprise, but I have no doubt if I showed up next whatever, at whatever time during legal business hours.
How many tours a week, like?
Honestly, it would look exactly the same.
I don't do tours often.
And you've been
I try
here for
to minimize
years.
It.
Yeah, so, yeah. Did he just do all this yesterday and just show off?
No.
But you never know.
In a day, honestly.
Usually.
Ah, see, but that's why it's done in a day. You don't leave it to tomorrow. You don't, and it stacks.
It's not you guys that I'm always in preparation for. It.
Exactly.
It's the state. It's honestly, the state, yep. They have their regulation, their rules. You do
and
something
you play
wrong,
the
you're
game.
Getting fined. So it's not worth it. I want to keep them happy. They come to make a recommendation, whether I have to do it or not. I'm going to listen. I'm going to do it because it shows that I listen.
And part of that is, part of the effective listening that you did for them, the understanding,
it's two ways.
Is that, and that second way back and forth allowed you, when I got there, to go, hold on, different rule set, new state, different facility license, here are our rules and structures, this is what I'm expecting of you, no negatives, no weird la-la, hey man, can we just, you know, this is the rules, the role, right? And if, very clear cut. And so having that knowledge, walking into it, we didn't have one issue the whole day versus, right, going on a tour and somebody doing this and somebody doing that, messing stuff up here. And, oh, what are you doing? I was supposed to do that yesterday. You know, it's like, that's the messes. And so I really appreciate that. It's rare to actually have somebody so clear, like, this is how you can best experience what I've worked so hard at.
Yeah, no, again, it's a, we're on our 22nd cycle, so times three, we've done it 60, we're on our 66th time now. Around
now,
the LED.
66 times, but when we were looking at the bed, it's over here and then over here, right?
Yeah.
Then over here.
But to be honest,
then over here.
That
you're
was
salsa dancing.
Yeah, but even that though, that wasn't a technique that we learned until several cycles in that we noticed.
Oh really?
Like,
so what? How did that cycle shift? Like you, in working with these creatures, these beds, right? You were like, oh, there's a better way. There's a more efficient way.
So we used to remove the root ball, and what we did was, over time, what we learned was we're harvesting our worms when we do that. And not only worms, but all the other biology behind them.
The entire rhizosphere.
Yeah, the whole
all
rhizosphere.
All of what you, the plants actually work so
everything
so
we've
hard
been building,
grow.
Pretty much. Or the plant's been building, I guess you should say.
The entire.
That's
true.
We were really doing not doing a service to the soil by doing that. We were taking the most valuable part out of it every time so that the soil wasn't advancing. And we were actually seeing less and less worm population in our soil. So then all we did was we just moved over 6 inches.
That's where you're going to have a higher concentrations of your cocoons and egg casings, which proportionally everything is exponentially going the wrong direction.
So we just shifted hole over. We created this grid pattern style where we just go north hole, left hole, or north hole, south hole between cycles. It allows the root ball to break down. It allows that biology to transfer to other parts of the soil because of the time needed to spread. We're not harvesting the biology. We're just taking the soil needed to plant the next clone.
You're not even harvesting the when your clones transition and are up potted, it's the same ecosystem on a smaller scale.
Yeah.
So there's a little bit of isolation, a little bit of, you know, decrease of the diversity because of that smaller scale. But the reality is the transition, there's always stressors you can add to the transition. But on the soil microbe, you know, rhizosphere level, is as seamless as possible.
Yeah.
Even the moisture content. Like, you know, I don't see you taking that ecosystem and then having to really drench it in good because you're going to saturate the whole medium. It's not. It literally is going, it's a transition. You're just moving it from one group to another. Yeah. It's a tourist.
And like you said, though, it's less shock to the plant. It's the same. Yeah, it's on a smaller pot, but it's the same soil. So
same
it's
soil.
Relatively same pH, same microbes, yep.
same biology, same team.
Across the board.
So worms, literally in the clone pot, there's already established fully mature ecosystems on that trophic level.
We just got to make sure that the environmental changes are the same, so that I'm not coming from a humid veg to a dry flower room. So
right.
on the operator side, things you gotta make sure to make the proper adjustments right away, because there's a day or two of like example the end of flower, I'm running my rooms on the dry side, so right. when I go to plant a room, I want to be on the humid side. If I forget right. to switch my humidity set right. point and I plant into a dry room, I just create a huge yeah. stress factor.
Yeah. See, and this is where the management is so important, and understanding how that one. I hear, is it worth it? That's what I hear people. Is it worth? I just don't see how. You know, what's it worth, right? And you go, wait, that 5 seconds to turn around and do it because you know you should, right? What's it worth? Well, you just paid some guy $30,000 to fix up the plumbing issue and this, and you lost your entire crop because it flood, you know. It's like, that's where the worth is, so that you're not actually paying the money. Yeah. You know, that's where the farmer transitions from thriving. Because the real worth isn't thriving. You know, the survival mindset yeah. that we were talking about yes. versus
surviving this. Versus thriving.
Yeah. So we lifted some of those rocks.
Oh, we forgot to lift more of them, though. We should have.
Yeah, but the nice part is we still did. Okay. And what the point was is that when you lift a rock, that's how you, it's a window, it's a portal. And you can do it if you have plexiglass. You just put plexiglass down, and then you cover it with cardboard, and then put something over top of it so it doesn't move. They'll just turn that like the underside of the rock. And yeah. so you'll see the worm channels and the insect paths. And it's really great for outdoor growers to do that as like a, what's going on under here? Well, you gotta put in a window.
There you go, that's a good idea.
It's kind of a fun trick.
I kinda wanna do it on my beds now.
Yeah, and so when you remove that rock, we did get the video of us lifting or just leaning over.
The pot.
Yeah, that was cool. And literally the bridge, what was the bridge? The body of a worm
yeah.
like coming through.
Now the rock mulch has been a great idea, man. It just creates that, the more consistent moisture. So in between waters, if the soil does tend to dry too much or whatever, the worms always have that,
it's a good
that
thermal
home
mass.
Base to run to, that moisture zone to run to.
Yeah. It also creates these almost like little windows where you're not getting that same green growth from your cover crop.
Yep, yep.
Almost, you know, like little snorkels, because those root mats can get real thick.
Yep, 100%.
But in the flowering room, the consistency of coloring and everything was really something to behold. To me, it looked really nice.
Thank you.
Rich. Nice.
Yep. We pretty much, I mean, we rarely see unhealthy plants in our facility. Just recently with these new lights, pushing the beds as hard mm-hmm. as we can. Now we've actually seen it to where we've actually reached our limitation finally. Before, lights are were the biggest limiting factor, and we couldn't even push our system hard okay. enough to ever see the limitations.
So now you're seeing, where's the limitation?
With the soil.
Okay, so
I was
now,
never able to reach that before.
Okay, and so how are you seeing the limitation?
No, I could just see where
or where it potentially your deficiency is
yes.
going to start.
Yes, well, now I can start to see yeah. the deficiencies.
Not that it is a problem, but you can see that because of this extra demand, you're going
to
see.
I can start to see the trends.
That we're going from tending to mining, right?
Yeah. So,
yeah. So this is really fascinating, because I look at this and I go, you know, we talk all the time about the living soil, how like paramount that is, but here's a technology that's made like a huge positive difference. So it's the marriage of the two. That, you know, because that is not negligible, the difference that these lights have made. It doesn't sound like it.
No,
I don't need to know the price, but would you say it's a double what a high-end price light already is? Like, you were talking about it's a more cost, but that's fine because
the
benefits are...
We're talking about Phos right now, the lights.
Wow, okay, if you
yeah.
want to.
No, but
by the way,
a good LED.
Now that we are... They're post lights.
Post lights.
LED.
LED. A3i is our mothership light, but they make several models of lights that are all extremely spectacular. I worked with all of it, pretty much all of them at this point. No, it's a really good LED company. They make really high-end LED fixtures that are just super well built. The reason I like them is because in the last 5 years, the trend that I've seen in the LED industry is that the biggest hang-up for purchasers was the price point. So what LED companies did was they solely went to
lower the price point.
They tried to tend to that. So versus focusing on building the best light, they just try to build the cheapest light. So they all try to build a cheaper price point light, and they all ended up building cheaper lights. Did not do that. They were the first LED company. We were trying all these new lights out that brought a light. It was like, whoa, this isn't a tinfoil.
It's a tool. Like, when you look at it, you're like, this thing is fully adjustable, and I'm looking at it, and you literally just Allen wrench, okay, that whole thing just comes off and snaps back in. It's like, this is a functional tool. It's like a multi-tool, right?
Well,
where like, I need it to be over here. And yet it's not just a plastic snap that's gonna eventually snap, right?
No, it should be well built. So that's one of the things that really sold me on the company. And just the way they future built them. They're extremely versatile from spectrum to the ramp up, ramp down modes.
You totally played with that. How long until you found it? You're like, hey, look, this is like sunrise and sunset, and here we go.
No, it's fun, and I noticed the plants less stressed out though by doing that.
Transition.
So the transition into those rooms, and when it's hard to increase the PPFD in the plants, I'm not just hitting them all at once. So we're just seeing happier plants in general.
I think this is almost shifting the role of a bud tender, right? It's like when you're walking that, and the person's watering, and they're just going, you know, they're not a janitor, they're the actual bud tenders.
The actual bud tenders.
Yeah, and the whole facility was hand watered.
Yeah, we hand watered.
And it didn't look like you guys were running anything but water.
The only thing we run primarily would just be our compost, extracts, teas, do the occasional protozoa infusion.
Can I talk about that for a second? The reason for that is this is an ecosystem that is populated, but that population has to come to something called a quorum, okay? And a quorum is what takes place in like the bioluminescent fish. Have you ever seen that on some of your?
Yes.
Yeah, right? That's actually a bacteria inside the fish that the fish can figure out how to turn on with an enzyme, and all at the same time, trillions of these independent organisms go, okay, cool. And light, right? Like, it's really trippy. Yeah. It's the same thing of like you eat some food and then you're like instantaneously you get like a film over your teeth, the biofilm.
Okay.
That's a quorum, right? Like your compost tea's brewing and then all of a sudden, right? You get the foam and the thick and the crust, right? That's one population hit its quorum and then went apeshit and it shifted the ecology, right? And so that's why teas are so volatile in comparison to an extract.
Yes.
You're just adding more teammates into that ecosystem because everything's eating each other and trying to create the most nurtured balance. And so it's a really cool thing to add those extracts without having to add nutrients to it. Because you're adding, they're called amino sugars. And that's why your in requirements change. Because when your plant is pulling the nutrition out of the actual microbiology, it's like eating a steak. So, but on that scale, the creature meat is called an amino, you know, sugar. And which is all because of the carbon, the photosynthesis sugars going into it. Like that's the meat. And your plant wants to be a carnivore and eat these biology sugars instead of in. And even the in that's processed through the air is through the biology of that bacteria we were talking about on the clovers.
Yep, rhizobia.
Yeah, and so you're just adding more livestock into the grow.
And for us, like, but as far as the teas and the extracts go, it's a process that we at times really don't even need. Like when you look at it under the microscope, all my players are there. Yeah. But to some degree, I have to use compost because it's part of our waste management program. Yep. So like at some points, I'm just top dressing just because I don't want to have 10 yards of compost building up. So
does this state have a requirement that it has to stay on site after it's been thermophilically
processed? That's something.
Can you sell it?
I've sold compost, but not cannabis.
Give it away.
Compost.
Give it away. I've given it away
in small bits to friends.
Well, these are all variables, but if the law says it has to stay on site, which in some places it does.
I don't want to make a business model out of it because maybe there is one day, but for the most part, I know damn well if I make a cannabis compost and the state finds out that I'm making compost out of cannabis,
instantaneous,
and I'm making money off of it.
40%. We want 40% of your compost money.
Some way, somehow. So it's that's why I don't want to try to sell anything right now.
This is literally the absolute waste stream. So we want 40% of your waste stream, too.
Yeah, I don't want like a 30% tax on compost.
We want your 40% of your poo.
So right now, we just put it all back in the system.
Wow. Okay. And, but that actually is part of... we were talking earlier about it can get too rich. And this is where the biology gets almost clayey, right? Like, it'll really thicken up because it's missing that other scale because it's still in a pot. And this is where the gopher would come and take raw minerals from the bottom of the earth, you know, dump it on the surface, right? This is where vice versa. Then once up here, it takes organic material, drives it down into the earth. Like, it had a role and a purpose. It still does. And so do we, and I call it hugel cultures. That's what we do on our scale. We take the trees and put it into the ground, right? Biochar, right? We're just working at different scales.
For sure. Yeah, there's definitely certain aspects of the living soil system that we can't incorporate indoors. Some of the macro features like ground squirrels and rabbits.
No, rodents aren't welcome. Rodents. They're not, we've been there.
Yeah, we got a rodent, we got one.
Well, and this is any business, right? And so your model of the restaurant or the hospital, they still got to deal with that too.
Yeah, true that.
But I will say, you got to know who you call and what they use. Because if you're trying to get rid of something and they're leaving stuff around your place making messes and it has any form of decon, rat killer bait, all this stuff. Because most often what happens is you tell someone who has time, which is usually someone who doesn't have anything better to do, to go deal with a problem, right? At which point they go to the store and say, hey, I need some help. What kills rats? And then someone who has less training than any of them sells them something, and then you get a contamination violation. So it's there's a whole process of going, no, the whole facility runs on this perspective.
Yeah, 100%. You gotta be really try to take an organic approach through and through as much as you possibly can. Obviously, you get a rodent, you get a bird, a pigeon. There's certain times you gotta eradicate certain things. BB gun is organic.
It's an acute amount of lead put into the ecosystem. And if fully composted, it's just fine.
What about the dogs?
They were actually our original
security. Not in the grow.
No, but when we first opened up, we actually lived across the street in the apartments for about a little over a year. And we would take the dogs to work every day. They run the property. So they ran the property for, I want to say, really closer to a year and a half.
So they're cannabis friendly.
But the thing is that's when we first opened up and everybody saw us and the pictures were taken of them at the front gate and whatnot. And,
with barbed wire? Like, it's a horrible image.
With Rottweilers behind it.
You're a big dude, kind of scared, beat people up for a living, right?
These are my dogs German Rottweilers. 4 years and people still think that they're there.
A big teddy bear. Look at you.
You never get that side out. I mean, they're like, you don't. They're primal.
Till this day, people think they run that property.
I love it. I love that. I'm not going there.
Well, you want to go there with invitation. Yeah. See, that's part of community, too. You work with each other and you welcome, but you have good boundaries. Or a lot of dogs, which are good boundaries.
And they're definitely... they're more of a liability as a security guard than
No, I actually think you giving a job to human beings is good too. He was a very nice guy. I've met two of them today.
Team human people.
Team human. See, it's important.
But yeah. The security factor is always a big deal though at these facilities. You always gotta be on point.
It is also a deterrent to have a pile of composting material outside the front door. Really thought it's a lot of robbers. They're confused. There's strange smells, barbed wire. We're at a farm. There's a goddamn cow sound over here.
Different is, like a lot of the farms I've been to, they are kind of out of town. And so then they do have their perimeters and they have security. You're like in town.
Yeah, we're pretty
centered. And you have neighbors here. So that is that a good thing? That might actually
It's a beautiful
be
community.
Helpful.
Yeah.
I mean, but you still have like security concerns.
Well, I mean, there's two ways to look at it. Yeah, we're surrounded by a lot of traffic, but we're also surrounded by a lot of cops. So if we're in some rural, out in the boonies, out in the middle of nowhere, it's going to be a lot longer for cops to get there.
The radio goes a lot faster than their car.
So being in center town like that is kind of a safer position to be in.
And it's a smaller town, so they'll react faster probably.
And one of the weird things is they let us do razor wire fencing out here. You can't do that in Las Vegas. So
there's an actual deterrent versus
So we've never had a random person walking on our property in all the years.
Do you have the whistling over there too?
No, but we have much better security cameras that move and track and trace.
So
what's the surrounding businesses appreciate? There's a security that also has a presence.
No, there
right?
was a shop next to us, the tattoo shop. Next to that is a shop called Threads. They were robbed one day, and the dudes ran across our security cameras, and the cops came in and took our surveillance camera, and we're able to help with that.
Yeah. They use dispensary cameras a lot for traffic.
Another service of the cannabis community.
I think it's happened for us once, if not twice already, that's they've been able to use our cameras to help.
Excellent.
So we got 5 minutes. You guys want to wrap it up and anything?
I would like to say thank you for the time and sharing what
and
you guys are all you guys are doing. It's beautiful.
Just kind of throw in there anything you want to talk about.
I'd like to say that I, no matter what, if Seal's intact, right, would happily share and partake in your flower. Total trusted.
Thank you.
Like I'd give it to grandma type of thing, right? You know what I mean? Like trust.
That's the idea.
And everyone has a grandma.
Everyone's got a grandma.
He'd give it to everyone's grandma.
There you go. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, I'm just waiting for this new building, though.
Yeah.
So what's coming up next that you look
at? I mean, for us right now, we got two things in motion. We're doing some R&D, some small scale hash, rosin, bubble.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Some different techniques
there.
All solventless. Right. So we'll be playing with some things there, coming out with some different products. And that's just going to lead up into our greenhouse project, our sun-grown line. So we'll be having a completely different strain, a completely different line of GLP, still living soil, still done with our standards, just using the sun in a state-of-the-art greenhouse versus an indoor building. So that'll be coming up hopefully next year. We postponed it this year because of COVID, but we're hitting it hard again and hope to have it next year.
Nice. Look forward to it, man. You're well on the way. It's looking great. Thank you so much for your time, and back to you, Peter.
Thanks, Ryan.